All right, how's everyone doing tonight? Thank you guys for coming out. Tonight's lecture, Inside Your Brain, an advanced lecture on brain health. Got a lot of great things planned for tonight's lecture. Take no prisoners. We take no prisoners tonight. Tonight, we're gonna start a revolution. We're gonna start by gaining your brain health back today. If it affects your health, your brain, I will be talking about it tonight. A lot of interesting things that I'll be going over, and a lot of my work that I'm talking about tonight is based off the work of Dr. Russell Blaylock, so I'll be quoting, going over a lot of his things through this lecture tonight. I'm going to take a break in January as far as doing another lecture like this. We're going to do popcorn and movie night. That seemed to be pretty successful when I showed the movie Doctored. This movie will be coming out very shortly. It's called Bought. You could see a preview of this if you go to boughtmovie.com. They're even going to show a little longer preview. I don't know if they're going to show the whole movie or a part of the movie October 10th for about 6 weeks. So if they don't show the entire movie, I'm still going to do this in January, popcorn and movie night here with the movie Bought. These are the same makers who brought the film on Doctored, which I showed here, which was very good there too. So that is coming down anyway. So since I'm not doing a main lecture in January, I'm bringing back my mini lectures for 2015. Surviving Winter, Paleo Diet, Introduction to Muscle Testing, Shop with the Doctor in the Summer Again, Cancer Prevention, Popcorn and Movie Nights here too. These will fill up and they will fill up quick. So if you're interested in these, keep that on your radar and sign up for it when you get the chance, because I will not be doing double classes of these that I did before, since these will be in-office lectures. I can only hold about 15 to 20 people in office there. I've got some Skype patients who are interested and want to see these types of lectures. I'm not super techno-savvy, but if we could kind of figure out maybe something in the future of recording myself and getting it live via webcam or whatever, we might do something like that for our Skype patients and patients who, if they've been overbooked and can't make it to the lecture, might be able to see it live stream there as well too. So keep that in mind. Following tonight's lecture, I always do about 10 minutes of questions and answers for you guys. Since I'm starting a little bit earlier tonight, I have some extra time. I might even get into muscle testing here a little bit tonight. So if anyone's interested in sticking around, I'll kind of show you some cool things of how we pinpoint certain things here with the patients that come into our office. And this will not be recorded. This is a gift for you guys for coming out. Our lectures are on YouTube, our previous lectures. If you're interested in these lectures, check out our YouTube selection there. DiverseHealthServices.com is where you could see our YouTube lectures at. We have a blog. If you'd like to follow that, like to post things on that, been a little bit quiet on it the last few weeks since I've been heavily focused on this lecture here tonight. Follow us on Facebook there. I like to put some trendy things and kind of current things on that as well. You could follow us on Twitter. We like to tweet. We do Skype appointments with patients all across the U.S., outside the U.S. It's very cool where this YouTube thing has gone here. And, you know, it's amazing, even the results that we're getting with Skype patients all around the world. I want to talk about Ebola right off the bat here. Origins of this disease, infection of the Ebola virus, named after a river in Congo where the disease was first recognized in 1976. It spreads direct contact with blood, secretions of infected people, contact with contaminated objects such as needles, and contact with infected animals. You can look at the map here. This is kind of confirmed cases since 1976 here. Ebola virus. Transmission between natural reservoir and human is rare, and outbreaks are usually traceable to a single case where the individual has handled the carcass of a gorilla, chimpanzee, or duiker, and fruit bats are also eaten by people in parts of West Africa where they're smoked, grilled, and made into spicy soups. Point being, if you eat diseased animals, expect to get diseases that those animals carry, period. This is a third world problem, period. Sanitations, antibiotics, nutrition. Go to Africa and try to find clean water. Sanitation is a huge issue out there. Be pointing to some things a little bit further down the line here as I kind of get into a little bit more of this lecture here. The National Institute of Health to launch an early Ebola vaccine trials in September. Federal officials say that there's encouraging results in primates. For years, pharmaceutical companies have seen little potential for profit in Ebola because outbreaks are so unpredictable and typically small. This was in the USA Today. I want you to focus on that one phrase right here. Pharmaceutical companies have seen little potential for profit. It's not about your health as much as it is for profit, period. And look who's gonna jump on this bandwagon here too. Monsanto invests in Ebola treatment drug company as pandemic spreads. Monsanto has partnered with the Department of Defense to use some proxy third party company to develop a vaccine against Ebola. The seed money began at $1.5 million. The value of the deal could grow up to an estimate $86 million. Of course, I got some interesting ties of some of the things I'm going to talk about with Dr. Russell Blaylock and some history of Monsanto that goes back to the mid-80s that you're kind of going to see here too. And I'm tying some of the things with the genetically modified foods today too. Like I said, sanitation, antibiotics, and nutrition. All these diseases were already on the way out just because of sanitation, antibiotics, and nutrition. Vaccines did not cause this downward trend of diseases in America. Now, I don't care if you're a pro-vaccine person, I don't care if you're an anti-vaccine person. Tonight, you're gonna learn what these vaccines are doing to your brains. More of a physiological, educational thing here tonight with this. So when they create false pandemics, you know, now they got a case in Texas that they're saying a live Ebola case. CDC is gonna push more fear. You go back to 2009 when they push all the fear with swine flu and only 12,000 people died a year in the United States of that swine flu, which is a manufactured virus. You look at the flu statistics in the United States here, 30,000 people die a year of the regular flu. 500,000 people worldwide. And there's a flu vaccine for this stuff. The flu virus mutates every single year. It's nothing but a guessing game of what's in the vaccine. It has more of a placebo effect than it does a beneficial factor. There's key points I'm going to talk about these vaccines tonight. Aluminum, lead, mercury, live and dead viruses, heavy metals, all these things have some component that's affecting people's brains, and you're going to see this here tonight. Well, if my kid has asthma, he should get a flu shot, right? No, then inactive flu vaccine does not prevent influenza-related hospitalizations in children, especially the ones with asthma. In fact, children who get the flu vaccine are 3 times more at risk for hospitalizations versus ones who don't get it. Interesting stuff if you look at the real research for this stuff. Randomized trial of vitamin D supplementation to prevent seasonal influenza in school children. Conclusion of this study, the study suggests that vitamin D3 supplementation during the winter may reduce incidence of influenza. Why don't people get sick with the flu during the summer? If you're out in the sun, your vitamin D levels go up, you don't see the flu during the summer. Simple supplementation during the wintertime of vitamin D. I haven't had the flu since I've been on vitamin D. Matter of fact, the only time I ever had one of those times was when I got a flu shot. So, and I just had a patient in last week. He said, my doctor stopped recommending the shingles vaccine to me. I go, oh yeah, why is that? He's like, the last 3 out of 4 patients he gave the shingles vaccine to, a month later, they broke out shingles. Interesting stuff here. Flu shot and Alzheimer's. Let's jump into some of the brain stuff here. Flu shot contains 25 micrograms of mercury. 1 microgram of mercury is considered toxic. Mercury is a brain toxin already indicated and a causative factor of dementia and Alzheimer's. Stats show that if you've had 5 consecutive flu shots between 1970 and 1980, you have 10 times the odds of getting Alzheimer's disease as a person who has 2 shots or less. Mercury is a neurotoxin. Period. Dr. Tenpenny, I'm going to work on getting her in our office and maybe doing a lecture in the future here, kind of like how I did with Mary Toko. You could follow her on Facebook, drtenpenny.com. She's a respected, one of the country's most knowledgeable and outspoken physicians regarding the impact of vaccines on health. She had a pretty good article talking about the measles outbreak in New York last year, and they're trying to blame anti-vaccine people and the measles outbreak and that kind of thing. China's getting this whole thing here too. China and New York have the highest vaccine rate of any state yet they had an outbreak of measles. So to kind of blame it on anti-vaccine people and the outbreaks of these diseases make no sense for a state that has the highest rates, one of the highest rates of vaccinated kids there. Dr. Russell Blaylock, so let's kind of jump into the lecture here and a lot of what is I'm basing this off of here. Dr. Russell Blaylock edits the Blaylock Wellness Report. He's a nationally recognized board-certified neurosurgeon, health practitioner, author, and lecturer. He retired from his neurological duties and devotes his full attention to nutritional studies and research here. A good bit of this lecture was based off the book Excitotoxins that he wrote there and some of those other things that he talks about through his the Blaylock Wellness Report. I got to go over a little bit of a brain anatomy before I jump into tonight's lecture here. The brain is the fattiest organ of the body, consists 60% fat. This is a key fact right here as I kind of talk about some things further down the lecture here. No pain receptors in the brain, so the brain feels no pain, weighs about 3 pounds, consists of about 100 billion neurons. Your brain's 60% white matter and 40% gray. The gray are the nerve bodies, the white is the fat myelin sheath in your body. Your brain feeds on glucose and ketones. Your blood-brain barrier. The blood-brain barrier maintains homeostasis and limits the entry of toxins and pathogens into your brain. Despite its importance, little is known about the molecular mechanism regarding the development and function of this crucial barrier. This is what protects your brain. Things that get in, things that don't get in. This is very important, as I'm going to talk about in some other slides, in developing kids, older adults, leaking issues, and things that enter and cannot enter. So even a challenge for pharmaceutical and traditional medicines, Western medicine stuff, because even trying to get certain medications to work on people and cross the blood-brain barrier, they kind of run into that risk of, or not the risk, but that problematic factor of not getting things to cross there. Here's a basic neuron, what it kind of looks like here. Cell body in the axon and through here. You get a nerve impulse and it shoots it down that way. Calcium channels open and it kind of fires. The nerve fires. Calcium channels and calcium and magnesium are synergistic things here for your heart. Calcium makes your heart pump harder. Magnesium relaxes your heart. It's kind of the same thing with the neurons here too, as we kind of talk about some key things and elements that Dr. Blaylock likes to go to for some conditions. So two neurons connect together, kind of fire a neuron, it goes right down the axon and travels to the next one here. Your brain consists of about 100 billion neurons. You have anywhere from 1,000 to 10,000 synapses with just each neuron in through here. So these are some key things and key little elements of anatomy as I'm going on through this lecture here. Excitotoxicity. Excitotoxicity is a common mechanism seen in many neurological disorders, including strokes, brain traumas, central nervous system infections, autoimmune disorders, MS, heavy metal toxicity, brain tumors, and the majority of neurodegenerative diseases such as Alzheimer's, dementia, Parkinson's, Lou Gehrig's, the ALS stuff here. So excitotoxicity. So what is an excitotoxin? An excitotoxin are amino acids which in excess cause neurons to repeatedly fire and causing cell death within 1 to 3 hours. So glutamate, aspartate, L-cysteine, these are just normal amino acids that are in your brain, but when they're at higher levels, cause those neurons to fire faster, 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 and repeatedly until that neuron dies. So, talk about specific excitotoxins. MSG, monosodium glutamate, is the sodium salt of glutamic acid, one of the most abundant natural occurring non-essential amino acids. Taste enhancer, it exhibits excitotoxic properties, has shown to cause brain lesions in animal experience, and can readily cross through the blood-brain barrier. And when it crosses through, it has that excitotoxic property. Causes the neuron to keep firing, until it creates issues of neuron cell death there. That's one excitotoxin here. This stuff's in a lot of food here today. History of MSG here. MSG was voluntarily removed from baby foods in 1969 following the research conducted by Dr. Olney here. He injected this stuff in mice, and when he injected this stuff in mice, the retinas got destroyed there, and their hippocampus and hypothalamus got destroyed there from the MSG there too. He went to further demonstrate in 1974 that when an MSG was fed to pregnant rhesus monkeys, it could cause brain damage to their offspring. Other researchers found similar results when pregnant rats were fed MSG there too. Now, I talk about the brain-blood barrier. That's important, but you got a placental barrier with pregnant women between the mom and the baby. So this stuff transfers right over and creates those issues in human adults as well there too. So some excitotoxic properties creates a lot of issues here today. This was just last week here. MSG, gluten, and inorganic. No problem, says California restaurant owner. We work hard to please everyone, but we know we can't. So if you're hard to please, please just turn around and go somewhere else. Thanks. I think we need one of these signs on our doors pretty soon. He put a note on this, a restaurant owner, he put a note on his door here saying, yes, we use MSG and we don't give a F about your gluten-free stuff here. Obviously, this is California, they're a little bit more on tuna stuff. They don't want gluten stuff in their food. They don't want MSG in their foods. People are slowly waking up to this stuff. Does everyone have a gluten intolerance? No. Are a lot more people gluten sensitive? Yes. A lot of the issues with the genetically modified foods, which I'll talk about further, you'll understand why there's more issues with this gluten sensitivity here today too. MSG, is everyone gluten or MSG sensitive? Yes. Not everyone will exhibit symptoms of it, but everyone has issues with MSG because it will create excitotoxic properties within your brain. Blood-brain barrier. Neuroscientists believe that young and the elderly are the most at risk from MSG. In the young, the blood-brain barrier is not fully developed, exposing the brain to increased levels of MSG that have entered the bloodstream. The elderly are at risk because the blood-brain barrier has been damaged through aging, disease processes, injury, hypertension, diabetes, hypoglycemic, stroke issues. Throughout a lifetime, the blood-brain barrier is leaky at its best. So this is interesting because it's not fully understood how this works. A lot of things that Dr. Russell Blaylock will talk about is a lot of antioxidant things that he likes for brain support because antioxidants pick up free radicals and it crosses into the blood-brain barrier pretty easily and has a lot of beneficial factors for people, for the brain, like green tea, which I'll be talking about there too. Aspartame is another thing that will exhibit excitotoxic properties. Before its final approval in 1981, a high incidence of brain tumors in animals fed NutraSweet was disclosed. Aspartame exhibits things as such as dizziness, visual impairment, severe muscle aches, numbness in extremities, pancreatitis, high blood pressure, retinal hemorrhaging, seizures, and depression, and it was suspected in causing high birth defects and chemical disruptions in the brain. Disruptions in the brain there. This is a pure poison as a sweetener. Absolutely pure poison. This is just a small list of side effects of aspartame. There is a laundry list of things that aspartame has been linked to. How does poison like this get in today's food? Well, Donald Rumsfeld. Let's go back to 1985, Monsanto. Here comes Monsanto here again. The chemical company Monsanto purchased G.D. Searle, the chemical company that held the patent to aspartame, the active ingredient in NutraSweet. Monsanto was apparently untroubled by aspartame's clouded past, including the report of the 1980 FDA Board of Inquiry comprised of three independent scientists, which confirmed that it might induce brain tumors. The FDA was previously banned aspartame based on its findings, only to have then Searle chairman Donald Rumsfeld vow to call on his makers to get it approved. When Searle was absorbed by Monsanto in 1985, he acquired $12 million. A little bit of political history of how this stuff gets in our food here today. Food Inc.'s a great movie that kind of talks about some of the current issues here today. And the problem is, a chemical company like Monsanto gives these politicians money to get in office. Once they get in office, the politicians protect them on the other side, all at the expense of our health. Fluoride, this subject here is like beating a dead horse already. Studies have repeatedly linked fluoride to reducing IQ and brain damage. Effects of fluoride on the brain, reducing acetylcholine receptors, damages the hippocampus, formations of the beta amyloid plaques, which are the same ones that are seen in Alzheimer's disease there. Competes with iodine, so exacerbates lesions induced by iodine deficiency, because iodine and fluoride kind of compete together and fluoride will win. Dr. Russell Blaylock talked heavily also as well as increased uptake of aluminum with fluoride toxicity together, which is kind of like a double whammy for your brain there. Five facts about fluoride. Fluoride is the only drug that is forced on as mass medication to the population of people with no control of dosing. 23 plus human studies and 100 plus animal studies have linked fluoride to brain damage. Fluoride competes with iodine and thyroid function there. So if fluoride and iodine are together, fluoride's gonna win and push iodine out of you. Drinking water contaminated with little fluoride will cause developmental disturbances. Ingested fluoride, 50% of the time, will deposit in the bones of children and 10% of adults. Fluoride will destroy your brain, wreck your thyroid, and wreck your bones. Those simple three things. Now, fluoride-based antibiotics are becoming more of a problem, as well as even fluoride-based antidepressants. The key point of this slide right here, cartilage tears. All these wrecked shoulders, knees, ligament tears, rotator cuffs, fluoride-based medications have been highly correlated to people with these easy rip, tear, pull, destroyed joints. Orthopedic surgeon, you talk to your orthopedic surgeon, he will definitely be on top of this because this is becoming a huge issue today. All right, vaccines in your brain. Vaccines and immunoexcitotoxicity. A great number of studies have shown that when you vaccinate an animal, the inflammatory cytokines not only increase dramatically, but so do the brain's inflammatory chemicals. The brain has its own immune system that is intimately connected to the body's immune system. The main immune cell in the brain is the microglia. We're going to go back to talking about microglia. So you vaccinate someone, their inflammatory cytokines go up, and the brain's inflammatory response kind of goes up here. Dr. Russell Blaylock states autism is a result of microglia activation here. And this is a little bit hard to read here, but there, I guess some of the slides are going to kind of break this down here. When these microglia are activated, these are like little vacuum cleaners in your brain, kind of suck up toxins and things, and then it releases an immune response, an inflammatory immune response, and a chronic activation of this creates damage to your neurons in your brain here. Is it one vaccine that causes autism? Sometimes, most of the time, no. It's the multiple doses of vaccines and the chronic repeated activation of the microglia and the inflammatory response in the brain that causes the autism, he states. It's not most, the majority of the time, it's not one shot. It can be one shot, but it's the multiple doses and the chronic assault on the brain. The rate of autism in 1990 was about 1 in 10,000 kids. Now it's 1 in 100, under that, closer to 1 in 50. What's changed from now till then? The increased rates in doses of vaccines. More doses, and a chronic repeat hit to that inflammatory response in that brain here. This is what activated microglia cells look like on a brain scan here. This is normal. This is when they're activated from an immune response here. I'm going to go back to something, to talking about this further in this, my lecture towards the end, when I'm talking about these issues with all these concussions in sports today and what that's doing to people's brains. So this was just recent here. The CDC whistleblowers admit vaccine autism connection. Apparently the late last year, William Thompson of the CDC contacted Brian Hooker, also the CDC, in a conversation, confessed privately to the fraudulent manipulation of data to cover up 340% increase in autism in African American males who were given the MMR vaccine on time compared to those vaccinated later. Now, this latest breaking thing doesn't look make Dr. Wakefield, who originally was pointing at the MMR vaccine, look too bad. Dr. Wakefield was saying, you know, I'm not saying the MMR vaccine causes autism, but for some reason, all these kids I'm looking at have inflamed guts and have issues with gluten intolerance, dairy problems, and are just completely inflamed in their guts. And he's like, there's some type of connection with the MMR and these autistic kids today. The truth about Gardasil here. In essence, parents being told that Gardasil does all sorts of things that it has never been proven to do, when in reality, it has no medical benefits whatsoever, but plenty of risk. Go on YouTube Gardasil side effects, reactions. Look at these girls giving testimonials about what this stuff has done and how it's just wrecked them here. I've not had one problem of fixing a female with HPV issues by simply fixing a folate B12 deficiency on them. All I do is folate B12, and I have fixed every single case in my office. Who's gonna have the biggest problems with this here? Women who smoke, because women who smoke, you will deplete your folate B12 levels the fastest, and you'll be more prone to the issues with the HPV stuff. I have not had one case I have not been able to fix with that, not one. I swear, I had a girl that had a HPV, a Gardasil reaction last year, actually about 6 months ago. Her leg was shaking. She couldn't control her leg. She lost her soccer scholarship. Her mom's a nurse. So mom being a nurse, she's got every single vaccine in the book. She's going to college. She needs a meningitis vaccine, the flu shot, this, that, and so forth and so on. Been to every doctor, neurologist, and everything, and everyone's scratching their head. And I go, look at this side effects of Gardasil. I'm like, your daughter's mimicking some of the stuff. It's pretty interesting here. Dr. Andrew Molden, this guy, I saw him in person. This guy was a genius here. He, late 40s, last year, he just died, heart attack, completely taken out. Not too many people know that he passed away here. Molden anoxia spectrum syndromes. The process that causes brain damage from vaccines is also the same mass process that causes all damages after vaccination. He correlated vaccines, kind of like Dr. Andrew, Dr. Blaylock, in saying that it creates an immune reaction in the brain, but it's causing ischemic lack of oxygen, mini strokes in the brain. He would correlate and kind of show you pictures of pre and post vaccinated people and where they stroked out in their brain. Going back to that one slide, you want to YouTube his stuff, Tolerance Lost. There's three series to that. Absolutely jaw-dropping. But going back to this and kind of correlating him and Dr. Blaylock together, was it one vaccine that did it? No. Was it multiple vaccines that did it? The majority, yes. Could it be one vaccine? Yes. The majority of the time, it was multiple doses. It's a chronic repeat inflammation effect and bashing the brain with multiple doses of the vaccines that cause this stuff here. So I just want to kind of tie those two together there for you. He has great stuff, but I just can't believe that he passed away just like last year. A 5-year-old autistic child, Dr. Zayed, the doctor of the urgent care, sent this patient to us here. Autism would like nutritional support, vitamin protocol, hair analysis shows high aluminum. High aluminum, short attention span, used to have a lot of anger issues. These are the symptoms. This is the chart. This is what we see. This is what his hair analysis looks like here. So going through a hair analysis here, I'm looking at aluminum, I'm looking at lead, I'm looking at mercury. Cadmium would be next there. This down here, just all your mineral absorption. We want to see things going back and forth, back and forth. If someone's dealing with hypochlorhydria, low stomach acid issues, which I'll talk about further on, things are going to go here and this way. So he's got high aluminum. This is in the green zone here. This is yellow, and that's red. His aluminum's all the way up here. Working with aluminum and lowering his aluminum levels in him, things start dissipating, and he started turning a corner for the best. It was pretty cool. ADD, ADHD, autism. This is the kind of stuff I'm going to be running on patients here. Symptoms of aluminum, senile dementia, Alzheimer's disease are observed, high aluminum levels elevated in children and adults with low zinc levels have been correlated with ADD, ADHD, and autism. How often are you hearing these terms thrown around today? How many pediatricians do you think even address or even look at that? Zero. I haven't found one pediatrician that will look at a hair analysis or look at heavy metal toxicity, but I see them all treated as Adderall and Ritalin deficiencies. Everyone's got a Ritalin or Adderall deficiency today. Sources of aluminum here: aluminum cookware, anises, baking powder, processed cheese, drinking water. Antiperspirants are very common. You're putting pure aluminum right in your system and through there, big time. Older adults will complain about more short-term memory issues. Kids will deal more with this ADD, ADHD stuff and get labeled quick for this. And the sad thing is, children are the new target market groups for pharmaceutical companies. They want to make your child a customer of their products to make them profit off this kind of stuff here. Let's jump into mercury here. Mercury may progress with moderate to chronic exposure, symptoms of anorexia, numbness and paresthesia, headaches, hypertension, irritability and excitability, immune suppression, possible immune dysregulation, more advanced issues of it, tremors and incoordination there, anemia, psychosis, manic behaviors, possible autoimmune disorders, renal dysfunction and failure there as well. So mercury is another common one that we come across quite a bit here. This was a 65-year-old female patient of mine. She's retired, travels the world. She goes, Jeff, you know, you fixed my depression, anxiety stuff. You know, I'm feeling great. But, you know, I'm finding the hard time finding the words I need to use. My memory's just not there. My clarity's just not there. You know, since we've fixed this thing, can we kind of zoom in and focus on this? I'm like, absolutely. Let's jump right into hair analysis and kind of see what it shows here. Her mercury level, right here, right in the middle and through here. Now, the gentleman who retired from the Channel 7 News, who used to do the sports in the evening, his mercury was that high. He had more of a tremor. He had a tremor that was just going nuts like that. He would hide his hands and press them on the counter, and you never saw that. He retired in his late 50s because his health was a complete disaster. I pulled his hair analysis, that's where it would have been. This is 2013. Here, let's kind of go to a follow-up here. Using where she hasn't used in a long time, amazing improvement with her memory. Feeling great by simply addressing that. Now, her mercury was a little bit stubborn working on. I had to use some infrared sauna stuff with her on top of the oral chelation, some of the other chelating things that we were doing with her, but amazing how much of this stuff's going missed here today. Now, this is a 5-year-old. Behavioral, temporal issues, a lot of anger outbursts, trouble paying attention and trouble falling asleep, no stomach problems, has been on some supplements for 2 years, zero help. Why would supplements help? They're not FDA approved. You know how many kids I've had in this office in September, just before school? Mom's literally coming to me crying. My child, they want them on medications. I don't want to do medications. I want to do it your way, do the supplements, do the food, but these teachers are all on my back. Just, this is the charts that I see. This is what comes in our office here. We ran a hair analysis on her. There's two key things here. Her mercury was up here. Her lithium was really low, and she's got a little bit of low stomach acid issues. She's not absorbing her minerals as well as she could be. A lot of things are going to the left instead of back and forth and more to the right there. Working on that mercury and that lithium deficiency, which is very prevalent today, less rage fits, dad noticing how much calmer she is, mom forgot 2 days of supplements on accident and noticed a big difference. It's great. And I know I'm doing good with patients when everyone else around that patient goes, holy crap, what are you doing with my granddaughter? Or, you know, the teachers are wondering, what are you doing with them? Because this is what we're doing and how we're turning patients around here today. Lithium, food-based lithium, Numerous studies have found that a common mineral heals the brain by stimulating the growth of new brain cells and protecting the brain from every neurotoxin. It has shown help with alcoholism, Alzheimer's disease, depression, Parkinson's, stroke, cluster headaches, traumatic brain injury. I tell you what, of the top products we have in our office and the home runs we get with supplements, this is easily in the top five. And some of you guys taking this here know which one I'm talking about there. This was just earlier this month here. I'm figuring, hey, this was recent. Let's throw this up here tonight. This was early September here. 10-year-old female, sensitive to sound, progressively getting worse over the years. Panic fits and screaming, gets upset easily. Some stomach pains, anger outbursts, OCD tendencies. This girl was so bad in our office, Tom, you were there, that our neighbors were going to call the police because they just heard this girl going nuts in our office and didn't know what our neighbors in her next to our building were going to call the police because they didn't know what the heck was going on with this girl here. I treated for her with that lithium deficiency in the office. I chilled her out in 2 hours. I go, I'm going to follow up with you in a week. But she was so bad in the office, I didn't want to bring her back to the office. I'm going to do a phone consult with you in a week versus bring you into the office. I'm still trying to figure this out. She's from Lake Orion. I fixed her cousin or something, and she's like, Dr. Jeff played a miracle on me. I could see, you know, Jane Doe's got the same thing going on. Take her to him, he will fix her. And mom was like, you know, we are having a problem trying to get her here, but we were gonna bring her in an ambulance to see you if we needed to. That tells you how bad she was. This is what we see. This is today's young future. This was later that week, or maybe, yeah, it was later that week there. Symptoms are much better, much happier. Started working on some blood sugar and simple B vitamin stuff there. She's doing very well. Mom's ecstatic. She's not having to resort to those medicines I was talking about earlier. Lead. Symptoms associated with lead are vague, but include loss of appetite and body weight, poor memory, fatigue, constipation, headaches, inability to concentrate, decreased coordination. Where are you going to get this stuff from? Welding, old leaded paint. They're drinking water, fertilizers, industrial waste, those different types of things in through here. If you live in Detroit, mark my words, you are contaminated with lead if you're drinking their water. This was back in, I believe, 2008. They showed this map here, and they correlated all the low MEEP scores with the kids due to lead toxicity because their whole water system is completely polluted with lead. Lead will make you feel dumb. It's hard to kind of base symptoms and have me tell you symptoms about lead toxicity. Some people, we had a girl a few years back, she went to the dollar store and just getting the dollar store lipsticks from China got completely polluted with lead just from something as simple as that. The majority is going to be tap water, all the things of that nature there. Iron toxicity. Iron levels in your blood can lead to the production of free radicals that can damage neurons in your brain. It also is believed that iron accumulation at high levels is extremely reactive to the beta amyloid plaques found in the brain of Alzheimer's patients. Sources, your tap water, well water, supplementation, iron cookware, workwear, and that kind of stuff there. These things in iron creates inflammation within your arteries and that, and also has been correlated to early strokes in people, 40s and 50s. If someone has a stroke and they don't have a blood clotting factor, which I'll be talking about later on here too, iron is a high suspect there with some of these issues with a lot of patients. Here's a key wild point for tonight's lecture. Heavy metal toxicity raises the risk of electromagnetic sensitivity. The issue of heavy metal toxicity in relation to electromagnetic toxicity may be one of the most significant. According to Dr. Amira's research, the more your system is contaminated with heavy metals from silver amalgams, fillings, eating contaminated fish, living downstream from power plants or whatever, plants and so forth and so on, your body becomes virtually an antenna that actually concentrates radiation, making it far more destructive. Now, going after hair analysis, because I go over all these hair analysis with patients all day long, 2 out of 10 people come back with a clean hair analysis. How many people do you think are getting hit with being in a magnet, an antenna with more heavy metals in their body and being more electromagnetic sensitive with all the Wi-Fi, cell phone towers, and all the electronics that were around today? Now, not 2 out of 10 come back with a bad hair analysis, but not all of them are heavy metal issues. Some of them are more low stomach acid issues. Heavy metal issues, I would say at least 50% of those hair analysis have some type of heavy metal issue there. This is from Mercola's website there, and off here, if you have accumulated toxic metals in your brain, and since your brain is an antenna, you will actually receive more cell phone radiation, which in turn can cause microbes in your system to overreact and create more potent myotoxins. So it creates this immune reaction, kind of like Dr. Blaylock's would talk about, the microglia releasing those inflammatory cytokines. And the more you're saturated with heavy metals, and if you park them in your brain, you're going to create more issues there. Kind of interesting stuff, isn't it? How do you know if you're EMF sensitive? Skin itching, rashes, flushing, burning, tingling, confusion, poor concentration, memory loss, fatigue and weakness, headaches, chest pain, heart problems, palpitations. That a lot more people are being hit with this EMF. Even though we'll say things like, I try to go to bed and I feel like I'm buzzing at night. I'm buzzing. EMF interferes with your pineal gland. So sleep issues today. All this sleep, I can't sleep. All this EMS affecting your pineal gland, which secretes melatonin to help you sleep. A lot of this stuff is issues with EMF today. EMF has been correlated to certain cancers here. Glioblastomas, the brain cancers, leukemia, eye cancers, melanoma, breast cancers, the parotid gland tumors. Parotid gland, your cell phone's right here, your parotid gland's right here. You're gonna have issues sometimes with that. Thyroid cancer, ear tumors, testicular cancer. testicular cancer, all these people putting laptops and stuff on their laps all the time. Issues like that. If I could throw one more cancer up here, I would put melanoma up here. Melanoma, I would swear, is more of an electrical cancer than it is a cancer from the sun. Now, if you have a brain tumor, radiation-induced cognitive impair, approximately 100,000 patients a year per year in the United States with primary and metastatic brain tumor survive long enough to develop radiation-induced brain injury. Neural inflammation is viewed as the primary, playing as a major role in radiation-induced cognitive impairment. This is kind of common sense. If you radiate your brain with brain cancers, you'll have these types of problems. Now let's take this at a lower level. Memory loss and diagnostic imaging. Less easy to explain is memory loss caused by diagnostic procedures as routine as an MRI, yet 4 separate studies have found it in significant numbers of patients. Something as routine as your CAT scans and MRIs are cooking your brain. These things are adding up and creating issues. Is there a long-term brain damage after bypass surgery? Duke University Medical Center study published in 2001 indicated that fully half of the people undergoing bypass surgery developed memory or thinking problems in the days following it, and these problems were usually still evident 5 years later. The average bypass surgery is 3 to 6 hours long. Now, being a muscle tester, a lot of people won't understand this unless you're a muscle tester. You will cook your brain, you will cook your heart, or you will cook your adrenal glands under anesthesia. You might cook multiple glands. Those three things are what you will cook most. And some people with cooking their brains will go cognitively downhill, and you'll see that a lot faster with some of the elderly folks there. Now I want you to keep this bypass surgery thing in mind as I kind of go along here. Robin Williams just died another month here. everyone missed something here. Everyone completely missed the train here. I'm going to point something out to you that me, you know, I'll go through a room. I will look at people's hair. I'll look at tongues. I'll look at eyes. I'll look at your nails. I'll feel your pulse. I will pick out deficiencies and see things in people just by scanning the crowd and doing this long term enough. Robin Williams, let's go to the next slide here. Look at his ear right here. See this crease in his ear? You're not going to look at ears the same after tonight. The shape of your earlobe and heart disease problems. The possibility associated between earlobe creases and coronary artery disease garnered attention when studied by Dr. Elliott was published in the American Journal of Medicine more than a decade ago. The results, 19 out of 20 people with risk factors for coronary artery disease also had diagonally creased earlobes. He already had a pre-existing heart problem going on. He already had a heart issue going on. He had a bypass surgery. They cooked a bad heart under surgery even longer. The heart is a very emotional organ. I've seen patients come in after a bad death, bad breakup, and muscle testing. Their heart reflex goes weak. Your heart is very responsive to emotion. They cooked the bad heart he already had. He died of depression mainly because he had a bad heart. Everyone missed the boat on this thing here. And when I used to be a patient transporter at a hospital and go through the cardiac area pushing patients all the time, I can't tell you how often I seen that crease in those ears with people with the bad hearts. Now, everyone's going to say, well, he's on antidepressants, and antidepressants, people taking those, yeah, increased rates of depression. Yes, and that could be an issue with some people, and the antidepressants could make people a little bit more suicidal because you're playing with the serotonin stuff and that there. But you have serotonin issues, which is a neurotransmitter. These are some of the issues that you'll run into with low serotonin problems. The people that hate the winter times that deal with the seasonal affective disorder are going to be the ones that deal with low serotonin issues with their brain. Keeping the vitamin D up because that's a precursor of serotonin, and full spectrum lighting during the winter to keep your serotonin levels up are two of the simplest things if you fall in that category here. Antidepressants dull your brain. The rate of antidepressant use in the United States has increased nearly 400% over the last two decades. Currently, 11 of Americans over the age of 12 take antidepressant medications. 23% of women aged 40 to 59 take antidepressants more than any other age sex group here. So many people are being prescribed this. This is scary right now. All these kids who shot up schools, the majority of them were on antidepressants, and they don't tell you this stuff because Big Pharma's got enough money to shut the media up, plus they don't want to scare all the people who are on this stuff here. Cops are in the office saying all the time, pull people over, I don't see illegal drugs in the cars. Everyone's on this kind of crap today on the roads. 2007, $25 billion were spent on antidepressants and antipsychotics. 2009, U.S. doctors wrote more psychiatric prescriptions than there were people in the U.S. And you kind of look at the medicines down below here. This is staggering and scary. Very scary. Some of those medications, antidepressants, have fluoride-based components to it, so that will even dull your brain even more. Here's the college problem. Everyone's on Adderall. Everyone wants an edge in college over the next person. This stuff's being so heavily abused among the college kids. Adderall and cocaine play the same receptors on the brain here. Look the same. This is what's going on today. Pushing your cortisol, increasing the dopamine. This is speed, cocaine on your brain. They both look the same. Now, talking about neurotransmitters here, neurotransmitters are chemical messengers that regulate the many physical and emotional processes, including movement, stress response, cognition, emotions, energy, cravings, pain, and more. You got four neurotransmitters, actually a few more than four, but we talk about heavily about GABA, acetylcholine, dopamine, and serotonin. You got norepinephrine there. To give you a quick brain talk, anxiety, depression, I'm going to fix 80% of the people. I tell this to a lot of people that come in the office. I'm going to go through into a mental institution. I'm going to fix 80% of the people in a mental institution just by doing protein shakes, B vitamins, and high doses of essential fatty acids. The other 20% of the people that need more help than that, I'm going to play neurotransmitters in their brain. That's as simple as it is right there. What's the best thing you could do for your brain, period? Fish oils. You got two components of fish oil there, the EPA, DHA. The EPA is the anti-inflammatory component. The DHA is what builds up your brain there. We use high doses of that DHA component with a lot of our people in our office here. Coconut oil improves cognitive ability here. As far back as 2004, a study published in the journal Neurobiology of Aging determined that coconut oil, the medium chain triglycerides, improve cognitive function among older folks with memory problems and even Alzheimer's disease. Now, your brain feeds on glucose and ketones. Why does this work? Coconut oil breaks down and increases the ketone bodies in your body. Those ketone bodies is what your brain feeds on. If your brain's going to pick two things to feed on, it wants to feed on more ketones than glucose, which is blood sugar. The ketogenic diet for the treatment of childhood epilepsy, a randomized control study. Epilepsy and seizures, we're going right to a ketogenic diet with a lot of our patients. The best known therapeutic application of this diet is treating drug-resistant epilepsy in children. The diet involves eating very little carbohydrates and large amounts of fat, leading to greatly increased concentration of ketone bodies in the blood. Your brain feeds on ketones and wants ketones. This will dramatically reduce the rates of seizures. This is the Lancet here. Ketogenic diet. What's going to increase seizures? Excitotoxic properties, MSG, aspartame, especially aspartame. Things that are going to increase that firing, those neurons in your brain until they overexcite, will overexcite the brain and cause more seizures in people. Medications that will cause memory loss. This is so key here. You got statin medications, Parkinson's drugs, tranquilizers, beta blockers, steroids, epilepsy medications, antacids, antidepressants here. The FDA warns about statin users with memory loss and diabetes. Your brain is 60% fat. Lower your cholesterol, lower your fat, starve your brain, and this is why you're seeing all this dementia and Alzheimer's today. Is because of your Lipitor, Crestor, Tricor. Lipitor is the highest revenueing drug in the United States. This is why all these brains are going down with the older folks today. This is one of the biggest reasons here, and it's turning people diabetic. Drug-induced nutritional deficiencies. All your antacids you're taking, you're going to rob you of your minerals, your B12, you won't break down your proteins, and you turn off your immune system, your gut. Antacids turn off your stomach, and one of the big factors that you'll lose is the B12. B12 has a huge correlation with issues with memory and Alzheimer's patients as you get older. One of the next few slides, I'll be showing that here. Anxiety and sleep pills also linked to dementia here. This is another one, just throw that on a pile. That was just this month here, something that was just published there, talking about these medications may kind of cause people to have more issues with the dementia. Bottom line, certain medications are dulling out the population of people today. Gray matter loss tied to polypharmacy. Patients with memory disorders who are taking more than three medications appear to suffer significant brain gray matter loss, researchers report. You know the average amount, let's say a 60-year-old patient comes in our office, the average amount of medications they're on, it's five and more easily. Why can't I think? Your medications are dulling your brain. Parkinson's disease. One of the strongest links to Parkinson's disease was exposure to pesticides and herbicides, especially these ones here. Dr. Russell Blaylock here, his parents both died of Parkinson's disease, so this is actually pretty close to his heart as far as addressing Parkinson's type problems here. Herbicides, fungicides, pesticides, these are all linked to today's breast cancers, today's prostate cancers. These are exogenous estrogens. It's feminizing today's males, creating more issues and gender bending issues, early puberty in females. A lot of issues today with the pesticides. Increased rates of pancreatic cancer. It's a poison. Chemical things in the pancreas do not go good hand in hand. Drug-induced tremors. Certain medications will increase tremors in people. Tremors are something that you'll see along with Parkinson's type issues. These are just some of the medications that they kind of talk about briefly exacerbating tremor issues. Another thing that will exacerbate it that it's not addressed in this slide is multiple medications, multiple chemical toxicities. Block your liver pathway. You can't clear out chemicals. You will tremor more. Antihistamines, antacids, antidepressants, Tylenol, NSAIDs, plug up that liver and you will not be able to detoxify chemicals and you will tremor more. Iron, a major factor in Parkinson's disease. A number of studies have examined the role of iron toxicity in Parkinson's disease. Most demonstrated that is a major player. Iron causes mischief by creating free radicals and creating this damage and increasing this immunoexcitotoxicity, and that immunoexcitotoxicity creates those neurons that keep firing, and that cell death that we keep talking about here. Brain strokes. This is the most up-to-date clotting factor section that you will see, me post ever again in future lectures, and you will not see this on Dr. Tent's lectures as well. We run a lot of the homocysteine lipoprotein A, fibrinogen and C-reactive protein. Here's some of the other sneaky ones. If you're having a clot or stroke and it still doesn't fall in this category, you gotta look at iron. Iron issues, high iron levels will cause people to clot and stroke there too. The point of this slide being, if you have clots and strokes and you throw a blank brain stroke, clot or something, those issues will push people into dementia, Alzheimer's as well there too. Little ischemic attacks in the brain there. This is a very key panel that will run if any these types of things run in the family. There's preventative markers to run for this type of thing. Alzheimer's disease is irreversible progressive brain disease that slowly destroys memory and thinking skills and eventually even the ability to carry out the simplest tasks. In most people, Alzheimer's disease symptoms first appear after the age of 60. Estimates vary, but experts suggest that as many as 5.1 million Americans may have Alzheimer's disease. Dr. Blaylock has stated and talked about Alzheimer's disease is what autism is of older people. And that's from his going back to that brain scan and activated microglia on an autistic child looked like the same on an Alzheimer's patient. The excitotoxins keep those neurons firing, create this neurodegeneration within your brain. Here's a healthy brain, here's an advanced Alzheimer's brain. You can see the differences in the shrinkage in the Alzheimer's patient here. Is your brain shrinking? A landmark study published in the Journal of Neurology, the researchers documented that elevated hemoglobin A1C is associated with changes in brain size. The higher A1C was, the more brain shrinkage there was. You know how much blood sugar handling issues there are in the United States because sugar's so heavily abused because people are unhappy trying to push serotonin and dopamine in their brain through eating sugar today. This is what the end result is as you get older, sugar shrinking your brain. Hypochlorhydria and dementia. Low stomach acid is associated with low B12 levels. H. pylori infections are more common. Increased homocysteine in your blood, bacterial overgrowth in your small intestine, food allergies, and raised cortisol. Aging and taking antacids are the common factors associated with low stomach acid issues. Also, people who are more sympathetic dominant, go, 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 stress, 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 you turn off your stomach acid, just being more wired like that and deal with more hypochlorhydria type of problems with that. that is related to dementia issues, as I'm going to talk about a little bit further with some of these factors here listed. Hypochlorhydrogen homocysteine. You need stomach acid to absorb B12 to lower your homocysteine level. Homocysteine level should be in a range 0 to 15. Ideally, you want to see it 10 and under. People that have higher homocysteine levels will have issues. Increased rates of stroke and Alzheimer's disease are very common with higher rates of homocysteine level. Whether it causes strokes and clots that create the issues with Alzheimer's, or it's more plaquing in your arteries and your brain, that might be correlated with this. It's a huge factor, and people aren't reading the number right because you want it under 10. I've seen people throw clots and strokes on 11s, if that tells you anything. Alzheimer's disease or vitamin B12 deficiency. Several studies have been conducted to establish the link between vitamin B12 and Alzheimer's. Some associate low B12 levels with both the symptoms of Alzheimer's and actually the atrophy, brain shrinkage of the brain there. Look at these symptoms through here: memory loss, weight loss, weakness, poor balance, depression, agitation, fatigue, constipation. A lot of these things kind of mirror image symptom of Alzheimer's. One of the biggest bang for your bucks you could do if you're a senior is B12. The biggest bang for your buck supplement is B12 for your brain. The power of green tea. Green tea is an antioxidant, readily crosses the blood-brain barrier, and it helps with those free radicals that we talk about from different things and inflammation and iron, that kind of stuff here. Interferes with the amyloid beta proteins that has been shown in Alzheimer's patients, toxicity of the neurons here. It's the EGCG and the brewed teas that you get that antioxidant property from green tea. Dr. Blaylock talks heavily about antioxidants because a lot of this free radical damage in the brain is creating the inflammation factors, and antioxidants pick up free radicals there. Now, this is going to back to the autism stuff a little bit with this next slide, but I'm going to talk about the multiple concussions and the problems that's going on with today's athletes here. In the case of repetitive traumatic brain injury, the first injury primed the microglia, and this priming state may last for a very long period of time in some cases. The second injury initiates a hyper response from the activation of the microglia with an outpouring of pro-inflammatory immune cytokines and excitotoxins. Immunotoxicity leads to neurodegeneration. So we were talking about the microglia with the autism, getting the vaccines and activating and reactivating and creating this pro-inflammatory effect, creating issues with neurodegeneration. Same thing that's happening with recurrent concussions today. You get a head injury, diffuse brain injury, contusion, the brain swelling picks up, you get the vascular effects. Then you get the changes in the blood-brain barrier from the biochemical effects and the microglia activate. When they get activated long-term, creates this immunoexcitotoxicity. So a normal brain, resting state, it's fine. First concussion, the microglia are alerted and primed. More concussions, higher inflamed rates, more neurodegeneration. Was it one vaccine that caused autism the majority of the time? No. It was the multiple doses of the vaccine. Was it one concussion that create neurodegeneration and Alzheimer-like issues in athletes today? No. Not one concussion, multiple concussions. Multiple concussions, the issues that create this microglia to be reactivated, constantly activated, and all these inflammatory cytokines that create this neurodegeneration within the brain here. This kind of shows your cytokines and the free radical issues that build up the immunoexcitotoxicity in through here. This chart shows it better here, kind of going back to that one here, the release of the cytokines, chronically recurrent activated microglia, and the chemicals that they keep releasing damages the neurons, and the long-term effect, you see neurodegeneration in the brain here. Look at the brain sizes. This goes back to your Alzheimer patients. This looks just like an Alzheimer's patient here to a normal brain. This is serious stuff with concussions because this is such a gray zone and no one understands this stuff. They had a football player 2 years ago. He was, mid-50s. He goes, he wrote a suicide note. He goes, something's not wrong, something's not right with my brain. He shot himself in the chest to kill himself and not the head because they want, he wrote in a suicide note, I want you to examine my brain so no one else goes through what I went through. This is what's going on today. This concussion stuff's pretty scary stuff. This was a 13-year-old female here, all the way from Chicago, diagnosed with post-concussion syndrome since car accident in 2011. Most of the pain was the right side of her body, hip pain, back of the head, and all this stuff. Had a lot of these migraines going on. $15,000 with a neurologist, went absolutely nowhere. Few adjustments of her atlas, her headaches are gone. She drives all the way from Chicago to see me to get her neck adjusted. I've never ran into a concussion patient that didn't have their atlas so far out of place from getting whacked so hard that these are some of the symptoms they'll come in complaining about. All the way from Chicago. Sidney Crosby dealt with a lot of concussion issues here and has been in and out of the game here. He went down to Life University where I graduated at, where I learned my chiropractic skills and adjusting and that kind of stuff. A lot of people did not know he was down there studying, or not studying, but getting chiropractic care, and that's really what kind of helped him get back in the game here. Neurodegenerative conditions. Conditions such as Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's, Huntington's, ALS, all have in common slow destruction of the brain. While there's little evidence that foodborne excitotoxins are the cause of these disorders, there's growing evidence that they can aggravate these conditions. Take a Parkinson's patient, give them more MSG, give them more aspartame, hit them with more vaccines, some more heavy metals. You'll make them tremor a lot more. Now, some of the things that Dr. Blaylock talks about with as far as brain and nutrients he really likes for the brain here, vitamin A, C, E, zinc, selenium, all your antioxidants there, ALA, L-carnitine, bioflavonoids, root in there, quercetin, NAC, all your oils, CoQ10, taurine, magnesium should be on here, glutathione should be on here. Those are two big factors that he likes to talk there too, because if these things are excitotoxic in your brain and these neurons are firing till they die, you got all these calcium channels that are open. Magnesium has a opposite effect on the calcium there. Are GMOs the new excitotoxins of today? Simple answer, yes. Why is there more gluten issues today? The genetically modified wheat, the hybridized wheat, is not the same wheat 30, 40 years ago. These things are not recognized on our gut as real food and creating gut inflammations. How's that correlated with brain autism, whatever, the inflammation from the gut and the leaky gut issues that we're seeing today creates more inflammation within the blood, which the inflammation from the gut precipitates to the brain, which activate more of those microglia and create that more brain inflammation going here. So that's how that connection has come along here. And that's about the end of the lecture. I got a surprise coming this April here. My wife and I are expecting our first kid. My wife. I put this at the end to see who really pays attention to the lectures. If you're interested in our office, make a protocol or specific for you. You stay in the process, biotics research. Order online, free shipping if it's over $125. Thank you for coming out to the lecture here. I got some extra time here tonight. So I'm going to go after questions, a little Q&A type thing. And I might even kind of do some muscle testing tonight here if someone's interested.